this is H2N, then the equivalent system is HN, which is convolution of H1N and H2N. So this we have seen, and accordingly we have noted that this is if Xn is input, output here will also be an Xn, and in such a case this H1N and H2N, they are inverse of one another. This is where we ended in the last class. Now again, I hope and believe that if not all, much of it you have seen before in the signals in systems class, part of it, where discrete time signals and systems were handled. So when you are describing a discrete time system, this is linear, constant, coefficient difference equation. We describe it in the form of a linear, constant, coefficient difference equation. So these are the constant coefficients that you see, which is which is built up on current value of input and past values of input, and also the current output. If we take yn, k is equal to 0 out, so this is yn. If we take this out, okay, so of course there will be an associated a0 yn, right? Then this can be written as whatever this quantity is there minus the rest of the quantities that are there, where k varies from 1 to capital N. Okay, so that means like past values of y output. Okay, so how we realize it, etc., the system level description, hardware implementation, those things we shall again revisit, you have not seen before, and discuss in detail. So this is the thing, and in many cases, in many textbook, it is customary to divide both the sides with this a naught, because ultimately we are interested in the output, not a scaled version of the output. So when you divide it, then you get this is a1 divided by a naught, a2 divided by a naught, similarly b1 divided by b naught, and so on. And that will be another set of coefficients, and they are also constant. So basically that will be bm prime, and that will be ak prime over here. Okay, so this will be set of bm prime, and this will be set of ak prime, you know, as coefficients, constant coefficients. So a naught will not be there. So this is the output. So this is the way also we write it. Now with that, if we look at something which we have seen before, so this is again that accumulator description. So this accumulator we can write in this manner, okay, and then if we take this xn out, okay, then we can write it xn plus k is equal to minus infinity to n minus 1, because k is equal to n, that we have taken out. So this equation can be written in this manner also. Okay, now what is this? What is this equation? I mean, what is this value? If yn is this, then here it is n minus 1, summation is up to n minus 1. So this will be your yn minus 1. Okay, all of you can understand it. So what is xn here? Yn plus, yn minus yn minus 1. Right? Now if you go back, right, and write one after another, like here, this accumulator system that you see here, this yn, can you just substitute and see that you will get back this xn, knowing that accumulator can be written in this manner. Do you get my question, all of you? We have done it in this manner, which is fine, which is correct. But I am just trying to get a output, intermediate output, and another output, and then we shall match that this output is same as this output, where the accumulator system can be written the way we have mentioned here. Can you quickly work out and write in the chat box? I hope you have got my question. Accumulator system described as what I just mentioned by this equation. What about this equation? Yn is equal to xn plus yn minus 1. And backward difference we already know. Okay. So if you substitute, can you quickly put it in the chat box? M. Ganesh, yn is equal to yn minus 1 is xn. That is your right. So backward difference here, if it is an intermediate variable, right? So this is yn minus 1. That will be the output zn here. If I say this is zn, to begin with, you do not know what is, whether it is Zn or not, Xn or not. So yn minus 1, this block, is your Zn, okay, the output, fine. And Ganesh, what is next? This is the second block you are talking about,
so or first block.
Sorry?
We already know yn equal to Xn plus yn minus 1 in accumulator system. So when we take backward difference, it will be, we'll get yn minus 1 equal to xn.
Right. Okay. So what you said is okay, but when you, you know, just show it in, or if you give it in exam and all, okay, then you have to take block by block. Okay. So your logic is same, but you have to put it in an appropriate manner. So you take this say yn, then you take this zn. So when you look at it, you ignore this one. And when you look at this, you ignore this one. You consider only this input. And then you match and you will see that that xn is same as zn. Okay. So you can get it from the equation as well. Okay. Yeah, Shubhik has written, right, okay, but here there is an assumption that this is the output, final output is xn. When we are asking you to prove or show, then you initially make it different and then you show that they are equal. Okay, so let us go ahead. Okay. Now, please write, all of you write, okay, the linear constant coefficient difference equation, okay, full form, please remember, linear constant coefficient difference equation for this system, okay. You can consider intermediate system, this system, that system, so final xn and yn relationship, the way you feel like. and you can write it in the chat box, or you can write it in a piece of paper and just take a photo of it and place it in the chat box. All of you should try. And even if I am going ahead with this thing, you can post it there. I can check it later. I'm giving you 2-3 minutes for this. And before that, this part I have perhaps did not discuss. So this is your the same system. If you try to put it in the form of a flow diagram, signal flow diagram, then Xn is the input, Yn is the output. This Yn is delayed version, one sample delay is Yn minus one, and this is getting added to generate Yn. So this is a summer. Okay, so we can write it in this manner also, in the block diagram level or signal flow diagram. More about it we shall see later. Now you write the equation for this. Sridhar has come up with something. Oh, that was the previous problem. Now the current problem, you write. If any of you find difficulty in appreciating this M2 and all. M2 is an integer. Okay, so you can write capital N or you can write 5, 6, 7, it is your choice. I mean, you visualize it in that manner. M2 is just an integer. Then how Yn and Xn is related? We know what this summer does. Here there is a subtraction sign. Okay, so there is a this side, whatever is coming is to be subtracted with whatever is coming from this M2 plus 1 sample delay. So there will be a subtraction over here. Accumulator we have already defined. Okay. Attenuator is just a scaling factor. Janesh Sharan has come up with something. Ganesh also, one is that yn minus 1 in that form. Ayan also has come up with Rudra Jyoti. Good, you can, I can give you one more minute. All of you try. I shall go through them later on. Udusharko also has come up. Pagan. If anyone is finding it difficult to understand how to decode or write in the form of a constant, a linear constant coefficient difference equation, given a system like this, you can ask at this moment. Later on, we will have more complex system, many block diagrams, okay, large number of, you know, path, parallel path. So you should not face difficulty at that time. These are early classes. Even if you have studied it before, in a review class, you get your doubt clarified. Okay. Right. Oishik, Hardik, Shivansh, Sharnabo. Right. More or less, I can understand the way you are thinking. Good. So you can keep testing. I'll get back to the discussion. More or less, I get a feel that your thought process and all. Right.
Could you explain it once? I think I am getting. I don't understand it.
Anyone has any doubt?
Yes, sir.
Did I hear something? Yes, sir. Please.
Sir, could you sir, the output of sample delay would be just multiplication, or would it be?
Sorry.
Sir, could you explain?
Once more, louder, please.
Sir, could you explain it once?
What? Which one? Which one? The whole thing?
Sir, after sampling delay, what would be the answer? X.
After sample delay. Okay, I'll discuss the answer. Okay. I'll go to that part. Okay. Don't worry. I got your question. Good. I mean, you should not feel shy. And irrespective of somebody is answering very fast and somebody, you know, finding it difficult, so it is doesn't matter. Okay, so I'll discuss that part, but more or less I have got a feel of the way you are thinking. But before discussing this particular system, those who have already answered, those who could not, or those who are finding it difficult or some issues, don't worry, I'll go to the discussion. But just a question to them. Is it an IIR system or FIR system? The whole thing, if you take from the entire thing, if you consider as one block now. This is my input and this is my output. What do you feel? What do you think? FIR system? Huh?
FIR.
Sorry?
FIR.
FIR.
So good, we have a difference in opinion, which is good. So the person who is saying IIR, why do you say that?
So that is kind of a loop due to the accumulator system.
So the equations that I have seen, there is a reference to YN minus 1. That's why. Okay. And the person who is saying FIR, what is your thought process?
Sir, when I have completely expanded it, I am just getting the equation to be y of n to be dependent only on the previous m2 plus 1 terms of input.
Good. Both of you are correct in the way you are thinking. And now we shall go and discuss it. And that perhaps will explain the other question also. Somebody who raised in between. Okay. Okay. So, as I said, whenever you have some such thing, you try to do it in a part by part, segment by segment. In the previous invert system also, it would be easier for you to justify or explain. Though in some cases, it might be very obvious, so-called obvious and all. But if you want to get marks and all, you have to show these steps. I mean, full marks, you have to show these steps. Okay. So first you look looking at x1n. So it has got two paths. One is this path and another is this path. And as I have already earlier told, that there is a negative sign here. So whatever is coming through this path, that has to be subtracted. This one is to be subtracted from whatever is coming through this path and to generate x1n. It is a bit, you know, it is not required in our in this particular level of course that you have another intermediate output here as x2n, which is just 1 upon m2 plus 1. So that we are avoiding, but definitely this part you should come up with a show it as a distinct step. You should not combine everything and come up with the final result. Okay, so it should show step by step. So this x1n, so those who found it difficult, it is, you can visualize it. So this part is clear, that it is 1 upon m2 plus 1, xn divided by 1 upon m2 plus 1, that will be over here. Now the one that is going through this part is just xn by m2 plus n, xn by m2 plus n, this thing that will reach here. And whatever is coming through this path, this path, this is delayed by m2 plus 1 sample. Okay. So whatever is available now, it will be available after m2 minus 1 indices or, you know, time index, whatever it is, over here. So I can write it in this manner, xn minus m2 minus 1, what you see here. If it is m2 unit, it will be m2 unit. If m2 is 6, then 6 plus 7. So it is xn minus 7. You can substitute the number. So this is xn minus 7. Right? This is your xn. Fine. Does it answer the person who asked what is happening here?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Sample delay.
Right. So the sample delay is basically just a delayed version of it. We kind of, you know, discussed maybe during shift invariance also. So this is your xn. So if it is delayed, so this will be your xn. Okay. Mm-hmm. And initialization, etc., etc. Usually we consider initially relaxed. So initial values of, you know, these delay units will be zero, etc. So that is another part of it. Mm-hmm. Accumulator system, we have already seen that this is to be like this. Now, if you substitute xn the way you have described in equation 1, in equation 2, then we arrive at equation 3. Okay. And so if you look at it this way, as your friend has correctly mentioned, that it looks like an IIR system, because that is how we have described before, that if there is a reference to, you know, output, first values of output, it will be an IIR system. Okay. So going by that definition, going by that understanding, if one says you cannot, you know, so-called find fault with him. Okay. But we need to be careful. As your other friend has correctly said, that if you expand it and, you know, you go into details, you might see that it is not exactly an IIR system. It could be an FIR system as well. So that is, let us see that part. Okay. Now we are, but then we shall reconcile also, of course. So this is the other way of looking at it, right? So this is the overall HN. So this is one H1N, this is H2N, this is H3N. And of course, this is just a scaling factor. So we are considering it this manner. And this particular system, sorry, this is, so this particular system is, this is the impulse response, accumulator system, this is the impulse response, Okay, and convolution means they are in series means they need to be convolved to generate the final equivalent overall impulse response, unit sample response. So when you do that, so what you see, del n convolved with un is un only, and del n minus m2 minus 1 convolved with un is un minus m2 minus 1. Okay. Now what is this? This un minus m2 minus 1. This is a finite duration signal. We have seen it before. Okay. So from k is equal to 0 to, so this is your un, goes up to infinity, and un minus m2 minus 1, this is a right shift that is there. So it will be somewhere, you know, depending on value of m2 and all, it will be like this. So all this, this part will be cancelling out. So whatever is left here, only will be there. So these are all zeros and these are all zeros. So non-zero values will be only this much, depending on the value of m2. Okay. So this is your yn. And so basically this is 1 upon m2 plus 1 xn plus xn minus 1 plus xn minus 2 up to say xn minus, in this case, if the value of m2 is say 6, xn minus 6. So there is no past reference of yn. So it is FIA system. So while this is, this kind of description says it is IR system, this is saying this is FIR system. Now we need to reconcile it. Okay. How can we do that? So consider this system only. So give del n as input. Whatever you get is your, this yn, if xn is your del n, yn will be your hn. Can you substitute and check that this hn will be non-zero only for some finite values and not, and will remain zero after that? Do you get my point? Consider for this del n as input, and at that time xn is del n, and at that time yn is your hn, and it is initially relaxed. Okay. Just substitute and see.
One would have to assume that HN for negative indices is zero, right?
Yeah, of course. If I work together with you, just first few steps or so. So this h, if I substitute, so xn is del n, so y0, now I shall write as h0, is equal to h minus 1 plus 1 upon m, if I consider say m to some value say 6 or so, right, just for the understanding, but we later on you can remove it, say 1 upon 7, then del 0 minus del, this is 0, minus 7. Okay. So this del 0 is 1 and del minus 7 is 0. Okay, from the definition of delta, del. So h0 is equal to 1 upon 7 only. Okay. Right. Now what about h1? H1 will be h0 plus 1 upon that 7, because you have considered m2 to be 6. This is your del 1 minus, this is 1 minus 6 minus 1. So, del 6. Now, these two both are 0. This is 0. This is 0. And what is 8 0? We have already seen to be 1 upon 7. Okay. So, H1 will be 1 upon 7. For H2, it will be H1 plus, this side it will be 1 upon 7. This is your del 2 minus del 6. Because now it is 2 minus 7, del 5. So both are 0. So it will be 1 upon 7 only. So this way it will continue. So how long will it continue? Till you have got this one from here, because that 7 here and n is equal to 7. So at that time, this 8, 7 is 1 upon 7, that is 8, 6, minus 1 upon 7. Okay, del 7. Minus del 0. Okay. So this is minus 1. Right. So 1 upon 7 and this is 0. 1 upon 7 minus 1 upon 7. This is 0 only. So H7 is 0. And what is H8? H7 plus 1 upon 7 del 8. And this is your del 1 at that time, 1 upon 7, del 8, minus del 1. All these are zeros now onwards, and 8, 7 is already 0. So this is 0, and it continues. So it is only non-zero for, this finite number of cases, 8, 0 to 8, 6. Okay? So this is what your friend was telling, or otherwise also you are able to see in this manner. Okay. Is it clear? Can I get audio response?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, the point to be taken note of, that just because you see that there is a reference to, the past thing, it is not necessary that it will be an IIR system. Okay. You need a deeper look into the system as a whole, and there can be a different way of describing the system, and you can get you can eventually see that it is an FIR system. An IIR system, FIR system, they are characterized in a different manner and have a different kind of meaning. Okay, so we shall go to the next part.
Sir, I have a question regarding the previous one, actually.
Yes, please. Yes, please.
Yeah. I mean, is there any reason for choosing M2 plus 1? We could have simply chosen M2, right?
M2?
Plus 1. We have chosen one extra sample as delay as well as attenuation.
No, there is no such thing as such. But later on, you'll see, if possible today itself. So we shall be using, we shall continue with this notation. Okay, since we are trying to develop a theory or getting greater insights, so we shall have M1. So you can very well understand why him too. Why not a mod, why not a mod, y plus 1. This question is very relevant. But it is later on, I mean, as the course progresses, it will be connected with some other thing where we shall introduce m1 and where this plus 1 will also come into picture. But as an independent an independent topic, you can disregard that part. Do you get my point? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so it is not, I mean, if you just look at it as it is, there is no such reason to look at, why M2 of all the things? Why not M1? Okay, but as I am saying, we shall connect it to some other thing. So there is a continuum. So this is a, course. It is just not an independent 20 minutes lecture on a topic, touch and go kind of thing. Okay, it is a YouTube material. So this M2 will come later in the story. So that time it will be easier for you to connect.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Otherwise, for as an independent discussion, you can you may not bother about this notation.
Sir, could you again explain how it came FIR using the supposedly IIR equation?
Yeah, I can do that. Let me come out of it. Okay. Here, this part of the discussion. Hello?
Sir, your screen is not visible.
Oh, I'm sorry. Kya ho raha hai? So what we discussed here, this part?
Yes, sir.
Okay, this is understood, no? That is why, we are saying FIR system. That is coming from that convolution of two subsystems, which are in series. Here we are trying to see how so-called IIR system can, if expanded or if, looked into greater detail, how it is actually giving a finite duration kind of thing. Okay. So first we go by the definition of what is unit sample response. Okay, unit sample response by definition. This creates issue. If I give, this is my xn and this is my yn. Okay, by definition, if I give del n as input instead of xn, I mean, if xn is del n, then whatever I get here is Hn. If Hn is a finite duration, that means Hn is non-zero for finite duration. So it could be like this. After that, it is all zero. Or it could be like this. After that, it is all zero. Or it could be like this. After that, it is all zero. Okay. So in that case, we say that it is a FIR system. And if it continues up to infinity, okay, So then it is called IIR system. So this is the basic definition of FIR system and IIR system and what it means. So del n given as input, whatever output we get is HN. If it is non-zero for a finite duration of time or indices over here, because it is sequence processing, then we call it FIR system. Okay. Keeping that definition in mind, so we look at this equation with greater detail. Okay. So this Xn will be del n. Accordingly, this will be del n minus n2 minus 1. For clarity in our understanding, or for, you know, to help us understand better, we are just putting some number here. Okay. Maybe we can put, earlier we worked with say 7, now we can work with say 3. Just so this is 3 minus 1. So this is del n minus 4. Okay. So this is my system, and of course this, now this is 3, so it is 1 upon 4 that is there. Okay. And here this is yn minus 1. We can go ahead with yn notation. Later on we can replace with whatever this we get because of del n is input, that as hn. So this is my yn. This I can, yn minus 1, I can bring to the right hand side. And initially relaxed means past values, I mean all these values are 0. Okay. Now what we see, this y0, so called y0, which actually is h0. Okay. Yn minus 1, it is initially relaxed, so it is 0. Right. So this is 0. Plus this is yn, so 1 upon 4 del n will only be contributing for n is equal to 0. So we are looking at n is equal to 0 case, and this will be del minus 4. So del minus 4 is 0 only. By definition, del n is 1 for n is equal to 0 and 0 elsewhere. So this y0 is 1 upon 4. Y1, that is n is equal to 1 case, is y0. Now y0 is non-zero, plus 1 upon 4 del 1 and del minus 3. Earlier this was del 0 minus del minus 4, previous case. This is 1 upon 4 del 1 minus del minus 3. So this y0 is now only contributing. That is 1 upon 4. And this side is 0 because both of them are 0. Del 1 is 0. Del minus 3 is 0. So y2 will be also like that. Okay. Because this will be del 2 and this will be also minus 2. Y3 also will be like that. That is 1 upon 4 will continue. 1 upon 4 is the past values of Y. Okay. So how long will it continue? Till n is equal to 4. N is equal to 4, then this becomes 0. So Y4 is Y3, which is 1 upon 4, minus 1 upon 4, del 4, which is 0, minus del 4 minus 4. That is 1. So this 1 upon 4 cancels out. So this is 0. After that, what happens? Y5 is Y4. Y4 is now 0. Plus, this is del 5. And this is 5 minus 4 del 1, which is 0. 1 upon 4, 0. So Y5 is 0. Y6, past value of Y, that is Y5, which is 0, and this is del 6 and del 2. So these values are all, never we are having a 0 case coming here, and past values are 0, so all these are 0. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So this y is nothing but your hn, because del n has been the input. So that way also you can see that, just not going by the way in the first place, whatever we get by substitution or our understanding of the system. And the other way, of course, sometimes you can go by this method also. Good. Okay, so we have understood, or reviewed the signals and systems convolution, basic description, basic FIR system, what they are and all. Now we look at, again, I understand that it is some sort of review only, isn't it? You have studied discrete time Fourier transform in signals and systems. Can I get your audio response? Discrete time Fourier transform, DTFT, you have studied? Hello?
No, sir. Lockdown just began that time and classes was not carried out after that.
So discrete time Fourier transform, you have not studied, you have been given some notes and all, probably not in a very I can go at a speed which is comfortable for you. You can definitely tell me that I am having some difficulty somewhere, okay, and I shall accordingly modulate the speed as well as expectation in terms of assignments and other things. Okay. So we had seen this is the basic convolution equation. Yn is convolution of xn and hn. So this part we have already studied, reviewed. Now if I give this input to the system e to the power j omega n, e to the power j omega n, okay, then what will be the corresponding output? Now e to the power j omega n, you can understand what is e to the power j omega n. Can somebody tell what is e to the power j omega n?
These are the complex roots of unity.
Right. Okay. So n is an integer in discrete time system for which we have interesting things, the periodicity, aperiodicity, etc. we discussed, isn't it? Before that, the signal generation part. So there we had seen cosine, cos omega n, we had seen sine omega n. So basically this e to the power j omega n, as you have correctly said, this is a complex quantity, right? And so in a complex plane, so depending on the value of omega, right? So you have n is equal to 0 here, then n is equal to 1 over here, n is equal to 2 over here, depending on, as I said, the value of omega. So there will be different points and its projections, cos omega n and in the real axis, and in the imaginary axis, whatever projection you get is the j sine omega n. Okay. So difference with this e to the power j omega t or so, that kind of thing, or that is that t is continuous, here n is discrete. So you have only specific values of omega depending on the value of omega. So this n is discrete. Okay. integer while this omega is continuous. Okay, so for, and this omega also says that if you are, you know, if this is your, this omega in together is your theta, this you have all studied before. Okay, so then how the rate of change actually, how, so this higher the omega, then your jump from one place n is equal to 0 to n is equal to 1 will be a bigger jump, okay, or a smaller jump, okay, depending on the value of omega. Okay, so this we can understand what is it is called g omega and what is its physical significance. Now, if this e to the power j omega n is given as input to the system, then we can substitute it. As we have discussed, that's this convolutional equation. You can exchange the order of convolution xk and hk, say xn and hn. So if you can write this as hk, xn minus k. So xn minus k, if you just substitute, you will get this quantity. And this is nothing but this e to the power j omega n, the same signal, whatever you have given, that's that same signal only comes out of it, but transformed by this particular block. Okay, that means if I excite the system with e to the power j omega n, this system, then whatever I get at the output, of course it is a LTI or LSI system, that's why these convolutional equations we are writing in this manner, so that is another part of it. So this is e to the power j omega n only, but multiplied by some quantity. Okay, now what is this quantity and what is the physical significance of it? What I mean, that part we are trying to understand here. Okay, so input is same as output, sorry, output is same as input in its nature as far as the frequency and other things are concerned, but modified or multiplied by some quantity. So what is this quantity? So this is the quantity, right? If I just expand, take the equation and understand the equation. Now in this equation, what we see that it is k is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity, hk to the power minus j omega k. If we complete the sum, then the difference of k, which was actually reference to n also, the time indices, that goes away. And you are only left with that omega, reference to omega. So this is a function of omega only. So whatever it is, if we write, since it is a function of omega only, by convention, we write it as h e to the power j omega. Right. So this is the convention. You could have written it a j omega or some other thing, but this is what they follow in discrete time system. And in continuous time system, we usually follow h j omega corresponding counterpart. Okay, that part is understood. So this h e to the power j omega is called frequency response of the system. Okay, so this particular quantity that we see, we shall see more of it, will be having in general, this is a complex quantity. So it will be having a magnitude part and a phase part. So magnitude part says what? Magnitude part says that this output, the signal that you have sent to this particular system, when it comes out, it is attenuated or amplified or whatever it is, depending on the magnitude part of it. So there is some change in the in that part, and phase part of it is means there is some lead or lag, or there is no change in the phase. Okay, so there is no delay or no advancing, or there is some delay or it is advanced or whatever. So this is what you would like to see. Okay, so the same signal attenuated or amplified or no change in the magnitude, and but delayed or advanced, or there is it is, you know, the there is no change in the you know time. So this is what you will be expecting. So if this is your discrete time Fourier transform, this is called discrete time Fourier transform, giving you a frequency response. Another thing, why it is called frequency response? That also you should know. I mean, you should ask why we are using this term. Now, if we plot this axis as omega, right, and this axis as h into the power g omega, so depending on the value of omega, if you substitute a particular value of omega, say omega is equal to 0, some value, something will come here, right? This is 0. So this is summation of, you know, these, you know, hk minus infinity to plus infinity, some value will come here. Then if you substitute a value of omega, say 0 point, because omega is continuous, say 0.1, 0.2, whatever it be. So if you substitute it here, so you'll get some summation. If you add them up, what about the magnitude part? So that will give you some magnitude over here, some value over here. Then similarly, another value, but you might see that particular system, we shall look at many different systems, okay, is not behaving exactly in the same manner for all these frequencies, okay? If it is a low pass system kind of thing, low pass filter kind of thing, so you might see that for lower frequencies, the, you know, magnitude, this whatever magnitude of h to the power j omega you have seen, it is, you know, more or less remaining constant, okay? But at higher frequency, it is coming down also, okay? So that is why it is called frequency response. So depending on, because it is a function of omega, so and omega is the frequency, so depending on the frequency, you are getting different kind of, you know, responses over here, okay? So this is magnitude response, this is, there will be a corresponding phase response. So we shall see both of them, okay? Now, one thing that we can understand because of, you know, the periodicity aspect of it, okay, this frequency response, this, if you substitute it in this equation, omega, instead of omega, if we substitute omega plus 2 pi r, okay, r is an integer, the value will be the same. So, this is h to the power j omega plus 2 pi r is same as h to the power j omega, right? So, this frequency response, we can calculate from 0 to 2 pi or minus pi to pi, and then it is just repeating. Unlike your continuous time frequency response of a system, continuous time system, where this capital omega will extend up to infinity, here it is enough that if we show it up to 2 pi or minus pi to plus pi because of the nature. The other thing is that if you want to get back hn from h to the power j omega, then we use inverse Fourier transform, discrete time Fourier transform, this equation, and we can get back hn. Now, to understand that how it comes and all, we can look at this particular part of the discussion. So, we are looking at hn being arrived from h to the power j omega. Okay, so this h to the power g omega, we can write it in this manner. Okay, I'm looking at the right integral. Okay, this can be written in this manner. Okay, instead of h, we are talking about in general some x. Okay, so basically we are looking at x e to the power j omega and xn. These are the in general, we are looking at it. H e to the power j omega is a specific case of it. Okay. So from the definition, and in one of the previous classes, we have noted that if in such cases, we should not use same indices. So this is M and this is N, right? And this integral, let us consider, is generating not xn, something x cap n. Okay? And then we shall see whether x cap n is same as xn or not. That is how you, you know, perform, you know, the proof and all, you get the proof. So changing the order of summation, right? So this is constant term, so xm you are bringing it out. So here, within the integral, this omega is there, so e to the power j omega n minus m. Okay. Now, if you look at this particular integral, okay, this part of the integral, so this is sin pi n minus m by pi n minus m. Okay. All of you can appreciate this. You have seen it in your in previous courses, or you can work it out very quickly. Is it okay? Can I get an audio response?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Fine. Great, great. So this is that sin x by x, that kind of thing. Okay. So here, this is. These are all integer values. Remember, m and n, these are all integer values. Okay. This is not t. These are integers. Okay. So when m is equal to n, this is 1. And for m not equal to n, since these are integers, so this is 0. Is it okay? N and m are integer, these are not continuous, unlike what you might have seen in continuous time domain and all. So when n and m are same, right, this is 1, and for other cases it is 2 pi, 3 pi, etc. Some, you know, some difference will be there. So that is 0. So this part is understood. So this can be written as del n minus m. That means whenever n is equal to m, this is 1. In rest of the places it is 0. So that is how you have defined del n and its different, you know, variations. Okay. So this del n minus m, now I can write in this equation over here. I can bring this and these two. So when you write equation 1, equation 2, combining, etc. So then I can write this as del n minus m. And in this case, only when m is equal to n, it will be multiplied with 1, and rest of the cases it is multiplied with 0. So xn only comes out of it this summation, and for other cases it is not, you know, contributing in any manner. So this x cap n is your xn. Okay. So this is a general case. So this can be, if it is a system level understanding, h e to the power j omega is describing a system's frequency response, and corresponding hn, it will be related in the same manner, exactly the same manner, right? So that is what you had seen in the previous equation. So this is the correspondence between hn and h to the power j omega. Okay. Now give me the DTFT of this thing. Write down in the chat box. Del n minus 1 into the power n un. DTFT definition, all of you have noted. I hope all of you have got the question. What is DTFT of del n, del n minus 1 and e to the power n u n? And you know the basic definition of DTFT, basic equation. One is one, Udu Sharku is writing, and second one is e to the power minus j omega, and right, Janesharan. One upon one minus e to the power minus j omega, good. Praveen also has done it, Hardik. Okay, first two all of you got very quickly, and the third one, perhaps you have to go to the GP series and work it out. Right. Anish also got it. If some of you are finding it difficult for one or the other, you can skip that, type the other cases. Yeah, good. Pavana also has done it. We are Sharnavo Sarkar. Right. Okay. I think anyone finding it difficult? How to calculate? Is there anyone finding it difficult? Shall I? Because not everybody is typing. Mittu Aditya, are you there? Can you unmute yourself? Mittu Aditya? You are not there? Okay. Rahul Meena?
Sir, this is Aditya.
Aditya, can you type the answer? Why only some name which is more or less familiar, becoming familiar because of their participation? Why not others? All of you should, if not all three, type a few. Or you are watching this in a posture where typing is a bit difficult. I have seen.
No, sir. I have internet issues.
Yeah, that is there. But all of you should make yourselves visible. I mean, now that we cannot do not have a classroom experience, so these chats and other things are where you can make your presence felt. Yeah, internet issues are there. Okay, I think if you go through the chat, if anyone has any difficulty, you can tell, otherwise we continue. Right, I think all of you are able to get it. So I assume that nobody has any difficulty. Can I assume that and go ahead? Okay. Great. So we go ahead. Okay. So first two was straightforward. If you just substitute, you will get it. And the third one, of course, you are looking at a GP series. And this is what is important. If you are writing, since it is up to infinity, so whenever you write, this was not asked, so you didn't write, which is perfectly fine, but in exam or in other places, always you write the condition for which the closed form expression that you have got, okay, is like that, that the convergence part of it. So that part you also mention. So fine. Now, if you have a ideal delay system, right, then ideal delay system we have seen before in that example, that M2 plus 1 unit of delay. Okay. So this is how you will be writing the input-output relation. Okay. So corresponding impulse response, unit sample response will be like this. Okay. And if you have corresponding discrete time Fourier transform, the frequency response, it is e to the power minus j omega nd. And we have already seen for del n minus 1, it is e to the power minus j omega. So del n minus nd to the power minus j omega nd. Okay. And if you have its corresponding real and imaginary part, this is how it would look like. Okay. Cosine and sine. Magnitude of this will be 1, right? And the phase part of it, it will show minus omega nd. So it is just a delay by nd unit that will get reflected in the phase response in this manner. Okay. Now we come to something because we are not working in, we do not have a blackboard and all. So I'll not ask you to work it on your own. Otherwise, in normal class, we ask some of you to come forward and work it out in the blackboard. So now here we want to know what is the DTFT of this. Okay. So HN is 1 upon M1 plus M2 plus 1, where N is ranging from minus M1 to M2. Okay. And of course, in between there is a 0. And this is 0 elsewhere. So if you look at the system or the expression of HN, then what you see over here, so some values are there, so this side non-zero values, okay, and non-zero values are you can figure it out. So if it is this side is say M1 is, so 0, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, rest all values are 0. So this M1 is 3, and this side, this is your 0, then this is plus 1, plus 2, plus 3, and say this is plus 4. After that, it is all 0. Okay, so this is the thing that we are talking about. Of course, this is not causal, right? Why I'm saying it is not causal? Can somebody give me an answer?
It has value.
System,
sorry?
Less than 0 as well.
Less than 0. So when you convolve, this part will ask future values of x. Isn't it? This h minus 1 will ask for x n plus 1. This h n minus 2 will ask for x n plus 2 in the convolution sum. Right? So to make it causal, that part we shall see. That we can shift it to the right-hand side by 3 units. Okay. We can shift it to the right-hand side by 3 units. and the entire system will become causal. Okay, so those things we shall see later. Right now, to begin with, we have some such thing. Here we considered M1 and M2 to be different, but usually in actual practice, other than the causality aspect, you will see that M1 and M2 are same. Okay, M1 and M2 are same. It is symmetric about the midpoint or n is equal to 0 in this case. Okay, this is the practical system that you will handle later. Here we start with a more general case. Okay. Now, if we go ahead, we just use the equation. Just first have a look at the steps, then we shall definitely discuss it. And here, if you look at this picture, this graphical illustration, you have this side M1, this side M2, starting from 1 to capital M2, this side minus 1, minus 2, up to minus M1, and 0 is included. So that's why the number of samples are M1 plus M2 plus 1. So you can understand that this is also a kind of, you know, moving average system. Here I have shown it in general for any, HN. Which could be, which is finite in length like this. But here, since it is a moving average system and all the coefficients are same, so basically you are having for this particular system all the values same, which is equal to 1 upon, in this particular case, we have taken 3 this side, 3 plus 4, 7, and plus 0 that is included, so 1 upon 8. So this height is 1 upon 8. This is same for all the cases, right? Had we made a causal system out of it, so this would have been, all these values will be there. So this would have been, you know, just a shifted version of it, the unit to the right hand side. So this is will be 1 upon 8. So this you just keep in mind. Previous discussion was for a general HN, which is extended to minus M1 in the left hand side and M2 in the right hand side. Okay. Okay, so I have some questions. If some of you have, how I can go from this step to this step, and can somebody tell me what is happening here? There is no 2 over here, some 2 is coming, and there is M1 plus M2 plus 1.
We have taken out that e to the power minus j omega m2 minus m1 by 2 common, so that's why it's coming like that.
You know, first of all, what is the intention? I mean, I don't look at this part. what is the intention to begin with to have a step like this?
To get a sign so that exponential is about same.
Right. Okay, so that is very correct. So this part you have to know what is the motivation, why suddenly you are going ahead with this. So in this kind of expression, we are looking for some such thing. Now this, where this one, where from this one has come and this one is not there, I mean, this e to the power j omega. Here I understand, here this was only m1. This is m2 minus m1. So there is a additional term e to the power j omega here, or j omega by 2, so as to say.
Sir, it is a half, not a one, right? So the one has been divided into both half and half into the two terms.
We multiplied it in the denominator, actually.
So this part that makes me understand it better. So this e to the power j omega by 2 and e to the power j omega by 2, so that is one is there in the denominator also, that cancels out. Okay, now I understand. I believe many like me can understand how this has arrived from this step. So right, and two, of course, that is there. This is intentional. We want it to be like this. So now, once we arrive at this, next is not that difficult. We are having this function, and as I said before, in all practical cases, you will see M1 and M2 be same. Okay. And so this part is the magnitude part. Okay, this is real. I mean, of course, it includes this one, right? And this part contains the phase information over here, right? So moving forward, if we just substitute some values, some say M1 is equal to 0 and M2 is equal to 4, okay, then if you plot this particular h to the power j omega against omega, this is what you will get. As we have told, omega is continuous in nature, right? And the first zero, I mean, of course, when it is, I'm talking about the magnitude part of it. So here, this magnitude of this part, magnitude of this is 1, all of us know, right? So when you are talking about magnitude part being plotted as frequency response, so this is what we are investigating, okay? So when it is omega is equal to 0, if this is sine, 0 by 0, that particular case, okay? That time, this value is your 1, okay? And first zero comes when this denominator is 0, okay? That this particular case, so if we can write it the sign, omega 5 by 2, isn't it? And in the bottom you have got sine omega by 2. Okay. So when it is omega is 2 pi by 5, sine pi comes, so that is your first zero. Okay, and we are talking about magnitude. Actually, it goes in the other direction. Since we are talking about magnitude, we are showing the magnitude part of it in this part, right? Next, 0 will come where? What is this point?
Four pi by 5.
All of you can understand that it is 4π/5. Right? So this will be 6, this will be 8, and this is 10. Is it fine? And of course there is a repetition and all. And pi comes somewhere in between these two, 4π/5 and 6π/5. Okay? So m1 is equal to 0, m2 is equal to 4, right? We have 0 crossing or zeros at 2π/5, 4π/5. And of course, if you plot it, you will see that magnitude is coming down. It is more like a low-pass filter. And moving average is expected to be behaving like that. So this is your magnitude response. So this is your phase response. Okay. Phase response, if you plot, if you see the book and all, it looks something like this. Okay. Can you tell what is happening, why these again jump, etc., that is there? There is a jump here.
Modulo pi.
All of you can understand that, what your friend has said. Can you tell in a simpler term the whoever has said, or anybody else can contribute?
The phase is a that would be a straight line, but we are taking it in modulus 180 degrees. So that is like
discussion. You see that it is this, this is this slope you can figure out. M2 is value and M1 values are already known, isn't it? So the slope is known, and this is a linear function with omega, right? And this is a negative slope, minus is there, right? So that is what you see over here. So the jump part, now your friend is explaining. So linear with omega, and slope can be identified from the equation itself. And the jump part, yes, yeah, go ahead, please. Huh? So this gap and this together is pi. That is what you are saying. This gap and this together is pi. So either you continue like this and or you have, you know, starting from here, it's all the same. So this plus this. Somebody who is trying to explain, or anybody else can come forward. What is this?
Sir, that gap is actually more than pi, right?
I don't know. I mean, you tell me. I am trying to, in this, I'm pleading ignorance, but later on we shall see. I can become. So you're looking at this picture also. Okay, this figure that it is coming to pi, etc. No, don't go by that. You don't need to necessarily go by that. Okay. Tell from physical significance. Often, you know, in the picture, you know, drawing, it is not always to the scale, or some issues could be there. Yeah, please.
Sir, the central one is from minus 2π/5 to 2π/5, and then it like the.
Sorry.
Isn't the central one from minus 2π/5 to 2π/5, or is it like from minus pi to pi?
You're talking about this picture or this picture, one or two?
The below one. Below one.
Below one. Yes, please. Yeah. Now go ahead.
Is it from minus pi to pi, or is it from minus 2π/5 to
pi? Minus pi to pi.
I didn't understand. Can you explain?
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, at 2π/5, the sine omega m1 plus m2 plus 2 plus 1 by 2 term becomes negative, right? So that adds a phase of pi. And since our angle should always lie between pi and minus pi, that turns out to be positive.
Right. Okay. So later on when the class ends, okay, you write down it in the chat box. Okay, or anyone, whoever else wants to share your view and all, I shall go through those chat box. I want you to remain involved or interact and all, not in a situation like this, it is difficult for you to call names and all. So why this thing is happening, that part you mentioned. Okay. Now,
sir, is the figure drawn to scale? Because
not drawn to scale. That is what I was trying to tell. It is not necessary that it is drawn to scale. So, as I said, I mean, it is always good that now that we are having these simulation, MATLAB, etc., is there. Wherever you have any doubt or whenever you want to, you know, kind of understand it in a get a deeper insights, and you can vary the value of M1, M2, and so you know, so on and so forth, different values of M2. So you can try simulation and see for yourself what is happening. So we are looking at simulating the same thing, whatever you have just looking at the in a manner like this. So those who are familiar with MATLAB code, they can easily appreciate. Otherwise, I'll help you. Okay. So this capital M is the M that we have mentioned here. So this M2 is M only. Okay. And H is 1 upon M. Okay. H is 1 upon M because 5 values we are taking. So we are taking 5 values here. This is M2 here. We are considering, excludes 0. Here it includes 0. So 1 upon 5. So 1 upon 5 was 1m. That means this 1m actually is generating a vector. Each values are 1. And length of this vector is whatever this m is there. So that is 5. And you can change and the length of this vector array will change. And each element is multiplied by 1 upon m, or this is 1 upon 5. So basically this becomes a response of a moving average filter, which is of length 5. Okay. And then in MATLAB, you have got a inbuilt command, freqz, F-R-E-Q-Z, which gives you the frequency response. Okay, so this is an inbuilt command. You can employ that inbuilt command. And of course, it will be generating a complex quantity, the quantity that you had seen before. Then you can plot its, you know, real, imaginary, absolute, and angle will give you the phase. Okay. So the one that we had just done, for in the previous example for M2 is equal to 4, which excluded 0. So that essentially in this simulation, M is equal to 5. Okay. It resembles or mimics that particular part. And these are the two diagrams which corresponds to 1 and 2. Okay. Now, can you connect this and this to pi by 5, this one, okay, and the jump over here, etc. This point, pi point, is this simulation proper? If it matches, then you can play with other values of n. Here, you're just trying to get whether it is proper or not by looking at theory or textbook and all. I mean, is it 2 pi by 5? This is your zero excursion. Now, what is this 500, etc.? This part, can somebody tell?
I guess number of points.
Number of points. Okay. So, usually on its own, it takes some 512 or some such, you know, points. Okay, in integer, you know, 2 to the power n, that kind of thing, that analysis, that value they put. Okay. And it goes ahead. Right. So what you see over here, if your 512 is your pi, okay, what is your 2 pi by 5? So 1024 divided by 5. Okay. It is 205 kind of thing. Do you get my point? Yeah. Are you all with me in this calculation?
Yes.
So this is what you see here. Okay. Then your 4 pi by 5 will be like this, multiplied by into 2, that is 410 kind of thing. That is this point you see over here. Okay. And this is your pi, and then is your 512, and then it goes on. It basically, you have seen the symmetry part of it. Okay. And if you look at the angle part of it, okay, so this is your that so-called 205 or that value. I mean, there is a fraction over here, so there will be small, you know, difference. So this side is you go by that linear slope, negative slope and all, that value that we had calculated before, and come up to this, okay? And then this is your pi is your 3.14. Okay. And then it, since it is in between minus pi and pi, this is MATLAB automatically takes the y-axis, you know, the length range. Otherwise, it could have been that. So you'll see that there is a jump and it goes up to this value. Similarly over here and similarly over here. Okay. Is it fine? And this real and imaginary put together, you get the absolute value. Is it okay? Maybe if you take one more example, it will be clearer. So now that you have seen that this matches, so we can go ahead and look at m is equal to 9. Again, this is inherently, it is doing a mapping of 512 to pi. Now, these points, does it match with theory? Can I get a comment on this? What should be this value? What should be this value?
1000. 2 pi by 9.
Is it okay? All of you are with me, or with your friend who has just said that it will be 2 pi by 9, then it will be 4 pi by 9, then 6 pi by 9, 8 pi by 9. Okay. So this is 9 pi by 9. This is 9 pi by 9 is pi only. And then it is just symmetric about this point, I mean, anti-symmetric about this point. Okay, so this is your 2 pi by 9. This is your 4 pi by 9, and so on. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Now tell me, what is the value of m here? You can type also if all of you cannot get, but some of you may speak out loud little later after your whatever calculation you are doing.
Around 17.
And not around will not do. You have to be exact. No around business will go. We started with this thing. We match that map that is a theory. Okay.
So it is hard to be precise, right? Because we don't really know the values of x-axis where it is meeting, where it is becoming zero.
You can see number of zero touching points. I mean, I should not give you a hint. I mean, I first would like to see if somebody can figure it out. Five 512 is pi that we have already told. Otherwise, also there are other things. How many such, you know, zero touching is happening? So is that, does it have some relationship with the value of m here? How many are there? How many will be there up to 2 pi by 5 that we have discussed, no, last time here, how it goes up to 2 pi. Then this is your matching with the simulation. Then we played with 9. Now I am asking, what is it? Do you see a correspondence? Don't you see a correspondence?
Yes.
So 17. Okay. So more voices coming on 17. And if anybody has any other thing, you can type in the chat box. I shall see later. What about this? You cannot ask me question back. You can only give answer. I have asked the question. There is something different here. I'll end in 2-3 minutes.
16, it is already 16.5. It is 16.
16. Any other person having any other observation? How did you get 16? Whoever has answered.
Sir, because there are 8 and exactly at 512th point it is becoming 0, so we should also include 8, I guess. So in total it will be 16.
Okay.
For 2k pi by m should be less than or equal to pi, right?
Right. So now, by looking at this kind of thing, and if I say it is a frequency response, you can tell the order of the filter and the basic equation and other things, isn't it? Only 17 and 16, you have got it correctly, right? If you look at the frequency response or alternate, I mean the inverse, I mean if you have the frequency response, you know the system. If you know the system, you know the frequency response. So one thing you might have observed, I mean this, so the filter is becoming sharper and sharper. The 3 dB cutoff, whatever, you know, is coming closer to this zero values. Right. And more about this, we shall see this side lobe height and other things when we go for formal filter design discussion. Okay. The other thing that we have noted, that when it is odd, this m is odd in this particular case, right? At pi, you have got a non-zero value. And when it is even, at pi, you have a zero value. And of course, you know that this is, you know, anti-symmetric about pi. So after that, it will go like this. It will, I mean, bigger and bigger and all. And then, I mean, dot, 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 it will be like this. Is it okay? So up to pi, drawing is sufficient. Any question? Any question here? Shall I stop then? It is already time for you to join next class. Okay, then I'm stopping. Up to this, whatever is there, I shall upload in the class folder and you can play with these. See, these are very simple codes. Okay. And see the what is happening to magnitude and phase response. So frequency response, we try to understand the DTFT frequency response. Okay. Thank you. Stopping recording. 16. Yeah, I see the chat box now. 17. Okay. I'll go through it later. So somebody who is giving an explanation or more, you can at your convenience, you write the in the phase response, the jump, why it is there and all. Okay. I shall see your explanation. Okay. So thank you. So I'm ending the recording and ending this meeting. Tomorrow there will be a tutorial, and for that you will be having different tutorial groups formed, and you will be attending that. You will not come to the main class. Okay. Right.